In this newspaper, this says in other countries around our globe, 5 million children can die a year from drinking water that isn't clean, and that's called contaminated water. So this biologist was telling you that the solar cooker could get the water hot enough to kill the things in the water so children wouldn't get sick and die.
And he's doing
that. That's really important.
He's traveled to many places in the world to purify the water with
There is an apparatus that has been developed that shows you how hot the water is.
It doesn't exactly give you the temperature, but I happen to have one in my handy dandy pocket.
Well.
And it is so simple you can't believe it. It's as simple as cooking in a box. It's just a little tube. And in the tube, when I can get it up. There we go. Okay. There's wax in there. And that wax is chosen to melt at 170 degrees. So you've got a good margin of safety there. And there's a sinker. This washer here is a sinker which holds that end down. And the air in here makes it float. So you put it in water. That end goes down, this end goes up with the hard wax up. When the wax has melted and gone down, you know that you have reached 170 degrees. And therefore, any microbiology in there has been killed.
Wow.
Now,
so you keep that in the water?
You keep it in while it's heating.
Okay.
Now, if you're heating it with solar, you don't have to worry about the stem because the string is nylon. It will work on any fuel. If you're going to heat it on wood or propane, you have to keep that string up on the lid. But when you finish with it, it will get hard, and you can turn it upside down. And the next time it will get hard, and you turn it upside down, it's a lifetime. Water pasteurization indicator.
So I have some water in the other container. If I bring it over here, can you show us how it's going to work?
Furthermore, if you go away, suppose you put your water out when you're going to work in the morning, and you want to know if you get home after dark and you want to know if your water's safe to drink. You don't have to know anything except where is that wax. If that wax is down, you can drink that water. If it's up, you cannot. Safely.
This is already extremely hot, and it's only been out there for that couple of minutes. Let's check this out, okay?
Is this our apples?
No, this is some water.
Oh.
Okay. If I open this up, you guys ready? Back on. All right. Now, then when we're all ready, did we just pick it up with this?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to put that back over there. We're going to test and see because, you know, we're scientists. And as students, we got to test and see. We always have to observe and see if we can replicate what you're saying. This is good science. So let's try it and see if it's going to work in our little laboratory.
And who discovered that?
Dr. Robert Metcalf.
He figured out a thermometer.
Professor at California State University, Sacramento.
Okay.
And he knew that there was something that could be done, and there was a man in the Department of Agriculture who was retiring, who wanted to try to make some kind of a non-temperature sensor. You see, most people in the world can't read.
Right.
They don't know numbers. They don't have a clock. They can't time something. So they wanted a visual, immediate sense. If that wax melts, you don't have to know anything else. Mm-hmm. And so that's what they worked for. But they started out with one bigger than a cigar.
Mm-hmm.
And tested all kinds of waxes. Then they find a place that has waxes of different temperatures. And all you have to do is order the right one.
Oh, my gosh.
They try to use beeswax. And beeswax will melt in certain temperatures, but they're different bees.
Yeah.
So you can't trust that. Best to get a little floppy, lifetime $6 investment. I've stepped on them on concrete, and it didn't break, so they're durable.
Good.
Okay. But the box cooker initially was a standard throwaway cardboard box inside another box, newspaper pushed up between it, lined with foil.
I have a picture of it.
Insulation between.
Yes, it's insulation. They tested insulators, and they found that crushed cardboard is as good as anything. It's as good as the fiberglass and stuff like that.
Wow.
And it's better than feathers, because the insects will get in and eat the feathers. And then you don't know why you don't
right.
have any insulation.
Here is a picture of their solar box cooker. This is from East Africa. Here's a picture of them making exactly the charcoal cooker in North Yemen. Here are some ladies. Here's a solar box cooker right here. Here's the pan, exactly like what we have. This one is West Africa. And here is the solar box cooker demonstration in Egypt. So right here we've got some, you've got to explain from the pictures.
Yeah, it is global. And that's getting a lot of changes as it goes, because each person looks at it and thinks, well, I do this, mine this way, and that's perfectly fine. They wanted to have one of the problems with a cardboard cooker is you have to have a place to keep it out of the rain.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you don't try to cook in the rain, so you don't have to have it in a rain, but you may not have a place to keep it safe. And so they do destroy it. I've had some last a couple of 3 years, but that's not long enough. So one of our friends wanted to make a cooker that would be global, that would meet a lot of the environmental needs, and would be durable. And they worked for about 6 years, testing one thing and another, and they would send them back from Minneapolis down to Taylor, and we'd put them in the sun. They'd put them out in the sun in Minneapolis. Great difference in geographic areas. And they finally came up with this spork. Now the spork is made out of recycled pop bottles. 68 recycled large pop bottles, I think it's the 64 ounce, goes in, ground up, reworked, goes into the shell. And then the other things are likewise selected to be as as Earth compatible as possible. They now, and they designed it so that it will ship easily. You sell it one by one. I sell them from the Sustainable Living Center one by one from single cartons. But they designed it to go in these great big shipping cartons, you know, the big things that they move on trucks. And they will telescope a lot of the bodies, telescope a lot of the lids, throw in the insulation, and some jigs. And the jigs, they send a package like that where someone has bought 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, and they are getting orders in that magnitude.
Wow.
They make sure that someone on the other end knows how to put them together. And so they put them together with local labor and sell them as cheaply as they can in the other area. They sold the first 1,000 in Afghanistan and turned around and ordered 10,000 more.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's a hit. I had an intern at the Sustainable Living Center who was fussing with me because the backpack and a box cooker doesn't work. You could take one on your head down a path, which we have some pictures where people have made them in workshops and they're carrying them home, but they're, you know, you can't backpack those things. And he wanted a little box. We did all sorts of things to make a little box, and we couldn't do it. Just couldn't get enough space to put in with small enough materials. But we have a friend in France, an engineer, Dr. Roger Bernard, and he said one day, you don't have to cook with this big sort of stuff. My wife and I cooked with just this thing, and he said, and I thought, oh, that's just too insignificant. We're not going to pay attention to that. So it took me 2 years to try it. When I tried it, it cooked good. And I did it because this guy was fussing with me about he wanted something he could put in his backpack. So what this turns out to be is there's two designs that come ahead of the one you know. One of them is just a plain box. You cut the front side down and draw a line at 2 inches and fold that front side out, and you build a floor in there, and then you put two reflectors like this. So you have a reflector here, and a reflector here. You put your pot, black pot in. Our Frenchman used a glass salad bowl.
Oh, wow.
But my backpacker and I decided that glass salad bowls are out. What can we do? And we got on to the heat-resistant baking bag, the turkey bag, and that works beautifully. So, couldn't fold that one up. That was still a corner box. But we took that and we made each panel that was reflecting. You see, we're scientists. We looked at what was happening. We went back down the radiation and we saw that we need one here, we need one here, we need one there and there and there. And it ended up as a 7-panel cooker. There's one at the bottom. There's one in the front, there's two at the sides, on all the sides there's an extra one hanging down. comes up to 7 panels, and you make a sort of a scoop out of this. And they cook very well. They cook nicely. And they're lightweight. They were pulled up to about an inch and a half thick, like a newspaper, like a three-ring notebook.
You can mail them.
And yeah. You can mail them. But it's easier if the school buys one cookie. It gets big pieces of cardboard, like from bicycle shops or glass shops. Those are two places where you can get lightweight, big pieces. And you lay your cookie down and you draw around it. You lay it down for the next child, you draw around it. And they all cut them out, they all coil them, they all make the slots, and they all fold them up. Everybody's got a sort.
That is a wonderful project. Absolutely wonderful. So you use the model that we've used at the school all the time, and everybody can make their own. But there's nothing as far as, like, you wouldn't be some copyright infringement?
Well, I got a copy. I got a patent on the first solar box we did. It cost a lot of money, took a lot of time. And when I went back with the next design, it said, you know, you're wasting your money because all they have to do is change one screw, and it's a new design, and anybody can walk away with it. So what I had accomplished with that first patent was nobody could actually lock it up, I hoped.
Oh.
But I've never patented anything since. And in fact, I don't want to, because one of the strengths of the solar cooking movement has been interested people volunteering their time, doing what they can to spread the word. And it could not have happened if it had gone on the patent business production route, because no one would have paid for me to sit in my garage and try to figure out what to do with a cardboard box. No one would have paid for me to say, well, it really has got to be lighter than that. You see, those are things that you do out of your heart, and the whole, it's not my heart, all over. The people in India have come to Sacramento, and I happened to run into them, Sherry and I there, and they were doing the same thing. They were making stoves, showing people, cooking, giving away food, all for free, because we know the world needs it.
You know, this is the same thing as this project right here, because, you know, you're being filmed on this. As the pioneers of solar box cooking, this very deceptively simple-looking little school is bringing the United Nations Peace Conference and the United Nations Children's Peace Competition for the whole world. It's going to be at this school starting 9/11, and then the judges are going to be like really high-level people, like, you know, Kofi Annan, people from around the whole world, and this film that we're making is going to be part of that. And there's the potential for this program that we've been doing this whole week going to 1,600 schools in South America to start out with. So the fact that we're hanging in here, that we're doing the best we know how, and I think it's really profound that what you told us is so simple. Because if we would have had some fancy cook thing here, people would have said, I can't do that myself. But you told us exactly how everyone can build one themselves.
And that was one of the goals, that people should go by and say, that, I could do that.
Exactly.
Well, we go home
exactly.
And do it.
Go home and do it. That's the point.
Yeah. And
we
encourage that.
We sold thousands of plans.
Do it yourself.
Yeah. So you have the plans that are separate, the do-it-yourself plans.
Oh, yeah.
We have this one here that she's showing.
Now, let's see what's this.
This is making the stove that Bob Metcalf,
the first wood one,
and that is the picture of the one that is still in his backyard, still cooking
for
him. And those are the doctors. These big kids are the doctors.
Now. Wow. You know, and we have one. That is down at the University of Arizona Extension Service. That Sherry it's all ready to go. It's going to be a permanent one here at the school, mm-hmm. And that's from these plans also.
Well, guys, I don't know because I don't know what it is.
Basically made from those plans, but I think the man changed it a little bit.
And now you see box cooker designs coming from a lot of different places. Other people are making glass cooker designs. That's fine. The thing that I know that we did that was really unique was this prop pull thing. And when you see that, you know it comes off of our work.
So the point is that, like, the one that we're cooking in today, that one's made out of recycled what?
Pop bottles.
Recycled pop bottles. But we don't have to have recycled pop bottles. All we have to have is some cardboard and some foil and some simple glue, and we have to have scissors or a knife that we can cut it with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You need a pencil so you can draw your outline to cut.
Okay.
And then you're going to have a black pot or black jar.
Okay. Just like the one that we have.
Heating box.
Okay.
Heat resistant plastic bag.
So the only thing that's really
clear insulating.
So that's really the only high tech thing was that NASA developed heat resistant
place, like poplar or something, a hiking place.
But no, it's a cooking bag, right?
We get it at the grocery store.
You get it
at
turkey.
You get it at
like a turkey bag.
You get it in
Bash.
Oh, okay.
You're just talking about the bag that goes over a turkey.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Right. The one that she's talking about, the one we use at the school all the time.
Right.
It's made out of cardboard that you put under your go like this. And it weighs how much?
Oh,
less than a pound or less than 2 pounds?
But you could salvage the stuff
exactly.
At the supermarket trash.
Exactly.
Now this was a stimulus to Sherry and I, because at the time of the early 1970s, the dumpsters were flowing over with cardboard. That's where we got our cardboard. We would go dumpster diving.
You go down to dumpster diving.
Yeah.
You'd get your cardboard by dumpster diving, and then what was the expense of, like, the foil for you?
Oh, I don't know what foil cost in those days. It doesn't cost a whole lot now. You take less than
get a roll of it. It's
get
cheap.
A roll, and it'll go for two or three or four.
Well, since you thought I was bringing the cook kit, and I thought you were bringing the cook kit, and mine got lifted, I'm going to pretend this is foil, right? Okay.
Right.
Here's the cardboard we have dumpster dived for. Let's pretend this is our foil.
All right, but since we upscaled from dumpster diving. We went to begging.
It's cleaner.
We found that if you ask the glass companies, ask the people that are selling the bicycles, they're glad for you to take their cardboard. Or they were until recently, and now they started selling their recycled cardboard, and it's a little harder. But you can still make it.
Okay. So now we have dumpster dove or begged. And that, but we have a nice little piece of cardboard, and let's pretend this is some foil we're going to get from the grocery store, right?
All right.
And it costs probably $1.29. So what do we do with the glue?
We're pretending.
So what do we do with the glue? What kind of glue? Like just like Elmer's glue?
I get Elmer's white glue and dilute it till it will paint.
Elmer's white.
Paint it on there pretty fast.
Okay.
Right. Dilute Elmer's.
So here we poured our Elmer's glue in here. Here we have our paintbrush. You dilute it a little bit, you pour a little bit of water in it, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Water.
There you go. Oh,
you're gonna get in trouble.
You get your paintbrush. You paint it on like this, right?
Yes, fast, because it's
fast,
soak, it's going to dry.
Fast.
And if you have daylight today, you may need to paint it on the foil.
Okay, instead of the cardboard.
You've got just to make a good contact between the cardboard and the foil.
You know, I think it might be easier for the kids to paint it on the foil to begin with.
Okay, that's a good idea. It's on the foil, and you go like this. And you stick it on just like that, right?
That's right. And then you go to your kitchen and you get your rolling pin.
We get our rolling pin. Here's my rolling pin. Okay? We've got our rolling pin. And then we go like this. What?
Mm-hmm.
Really flat. Flat.
Yeah. Okay? And that makes it all as flat as possible. Okay. And that makes it adhere well. On there, because that does block the reflection. But you can...
If I get a little blue on the foil, can I take it off right away?
You can take it off right away, but don't just stretch. Just pick it off, because it's going to cover a little bit.
Okay. I'm going to peel it off. Okay?
Even if we don't see it at all.
Just sort of get it off with this little.
It's all clean.
Did you hear that?
The glue's dry. I've rolled it flat. And now what do I do?
I can't talk it right.
Well, you already cut it before you did that, I think.
Okay. So the shape is already where I need it.
Uh-huh.
So, like...
And then you have the... It depends on your design. You see, you're thinking one design, I'm thinking another.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever the design is, you do cut it and fold it and secure.
Okay. All right. Okay, so ingredient number one, cardboard.
Cardboard.
Ingredient number two.
Tin foil.
Foil. Ingredient number three, glue.
Glue.
Okay. Utensil number four, rolling pin. And utensil number five, paintbrush. Okay.
Scissors.
And then utensil number six is scissors. And we can cook with that.
What did we need the scissors
for? And then for shape, you got to shape it the shape that you need to have to be able to fold it up. Now, I don't want to actually cut this because, there is the Kerr Cole cooker. And there's Sherry Cole right there
and
from one of her.
That must have been years ago. What year is that?
86.
I want to know how come you used to wear glasses and you don't have to now.
Because she's wonderful. Because she's regenerated. Because she's getting younger all the time. So, now.
I got to the point of bifocals. And then got onto diet and exercise.
And you don't have to wear them?
I don't wear glasses.
No kidding.
Isn't that pretty incredible?
Yes, that's very incredible.
Now we've cut it. We've folded it. Okay, and then we have to have utensil number seven. Which is a black pot, just like the one you guys already saw. Or you could, something that's not going to off-gas, so you can paint something black. Okay.
Yes, and you generally pick a paint that is used around food, like a barbecue paint.
Yeah,
don't
really
pick an
important.
Engine paint. An engine paint may stink for months because it never gets high enough to set. The barbecue paints will set and stop giving off an odor at a much lower temperature.
So I've got a barbecue paint right here. I'm going to put I have a bottle right here. I'm going to my barbecue paint is black. It's not any other kind of paint except barbecue paint, because that withstands heat, right? I'm going to go like this.
We'll go for that, but I'll tell you something in a minute.
Okay.
And you can do it on Kerr jars.
On Kerr jars. The only thing that Candace, the only thing we have to get that's high tech, we do have to go to the grocery store and get a heat resistant, just a turkey bag, okay?
Turkey bag.
There's two things I need to upgrade this.
Okay.
One of them is that turkey bag, which I thought was essential and irreplaceable.
Okay.
My friend from Ecuador says they can't get them. And so what he did was take bamboo and make a little cage over his pot and put regular cooking foil so that it never, in plastic, regular kitchen plastic, dumpster diving again, so that it did not touch the hot pot. If it doesn't touch the hot pot, it will last for a number of cookies.
Now,
and then you can put another one over a cage, yeah. You see.
That is absolutely great.
And that moves it out of our grocery stores.
You know, we're worried about our guest speaker's solar cooking. Shall we move you a little forward so you're out of the sun? Well, do you mind now? Could we check and see if our water is purified yet?
What? It's,
whoa!
It's
did
what?
You?
200 Fahrenheit.
Oh, Don said that the stove said, our little thing said 200 Fahrenheit. Inside the pot, it might not be quite that hot yet, but let's... This is a scientific experiment. Let's go see. Then we're going to go inside where it's cool. Yes, dear?
Couldn't we have cooked Buffy's egg that she laid yesterday?
We should have cooked Buffy's egg. Now, where we're going to do our scientific test to see if this little bitty solar cooker made out of recycled pop bottles really did get hot enough to purify this water. You guys ready? Okay. One. Two. Three. Da, da, ah. Look at that. Tell me what that means. You know that, and so all this water now, if mothers want to give their kids this water to drink, it's entirely safe. No one would get sick. No one would get typhoid. Other waterborne pathogens that cause diseases are all purified and they're gone. And so now mothers can give their children this water safely and no one would get sick or die. That's really a very important thing from our solar cooker.
Heather, you notice how you took this out, you poured it out, and you go in there and fish with something.
No.
You pour from that, this out, put a lid on a small amount of it.
Good. Now I'm going to tip, this is my clean water container right here. I would put something on top of that to cover it up so it would stay nice and clean. And now I can reuse my pot. Now, look at this. Show us how. Look, can you see what color is it now?
I tipped it up and got the part up here too. But it's really hard down here. So that's the end of the door.
It's completely congealed. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? Really amazing. Okay, you guys purified water.
Woo!
Now that we've purified our water, are we ready to have some good solar cooked food to eat? Another really serious problem besides cooking. Lots of people in the world, can you guys see that picture here? Can you guys see? Lots of people in the world might not have clean water to drink like we do. Now that's really serious. What if our goats were outside and they were stepping, we had a little lake of water and they were stepping in that water and going poop in the water, would we want to drink it?
No.
But, you know what you can use our box, what you can use these solar cookers for? I'm going to show you. If you have some dirty water, this is water from the sink. If you have some, but let's pretend it's dirty water, and you put it in here, Now, we need to get this up to only, outside just says 100 degrees, right? If this water would get only up to 160 degrees, did you know that will kill anything that makes people sick? And those are called pathogens, or things that make people sick. They're like the kind of germ that's in the water. Any pathogen that could make people sick in this water, if it gets to be up to 160 degrees, it will be pasteurized. Do you know that word pasteurized? Have you heard that about milk? It's because the guy, the gentleman scientist who discovered this was called Louis Pasteur. So we say, if we get this up to 160 degrees, it pasteurizes the water or kills any pathogens, anything's going to hurt people. Now, look at this amazing little invention. Did you have something to say, Nicholas?
Is that guy, the guy who discovered that, did he die already?
Yeah, Louis Pasteur lived quite a while ago. He lived almost 200 years ago. Yeah, he's dead now, but you know what? His work still helps every single one of us. Yes.
And because when the temperature gets really, really hot,
that's when it really kills germs. Exactly. Exactly. Heard what she said? She said something really important. Hot temperatures kill germs. So, this is a neat little thing. This is called a water purifier indicator, okay? So, for short, let's just call it a WAPI, okay? Can you say that?
WAPI.
Now, this little WAPI is very neat. This is a plastic, let me show you. This is plastic, listen. It's just plastic, okay? It's a little tube, and inside of here, it has some wax. And this wax will melt and turn to a liquid with 160 degrees. Shall we do an experiment?
Yes.
Let's do it. Okay, let's put this into the water. I think I need to put a little bit more water in here.
Yeah.
We'll cover it with water. It doesn't really kill them. Oftentimes it makes them become dormant. Okay, it's cold. Now, this our temperature gauge, okay, it says that this water is well below 100 degrees. So, okay, so even though it's 100 degrees outside, this water is very cool. Now, okay, so we have our WAPI in here. Let's put the lid on. Would you open up the solar cooker? Okay, we'll put this black container in our solar cooker. Some land where they didn't have clean water. Like our water is clean with the dipwork from our pond, but what's it clean with oftentimes?
Oxygen.
Yeah, oxygen. Yeah, oxygen does clean it. But there's another thing. Chlorine, right. Right. At the water purification plant, they put chlorine into our water, and that also kills pathogens. Okay. But heat is the best way to do it. So, now, we're going to put this in here, and if I was a mama someplace where they didn't have clean water, if I got my water up to 160 degrees and I kept the lid on the water so it stayed clean, then I could let my kids drink it and they wouldn't get sick. So we'll do this experiment, okay? This is experiment number one.
I'm going to take the first grader.
Yay! Yeah!
Wait.
Line up, right here, right here, line up. Line up. Line up. Line up.
Okay, the first grader. Please line up at the barn, first grader.
You're lucky, Stephanie.
She has to go to the ballet, though.
I know.
Oh, you have ballet now, honey?
I do.
Oh, you do right now?
Well,
oh, good.
Actually, I got this brilliant idea that maybe I could take her in the bathroom and make her dress her.
Oh,
it's a good idea. I got some stuff out before. I don't mind.
No, no,
you have enough time. Did you hear that, you guys? The light goes, the sunlight gets more and more bright. It's about 60% in the morning, and when it's straight overhead, which height is 100%? They'd be almost with a sunstroke. So, you guys, listen. It was 2:30. It's 2:30 right now. It might not be as hot as it could be. So, first, let's check and see if our water got pasteurized. Okay. Now, this says in here. Can you guys see this? Excuse me. This says 200 degrees. Can you move back, honey? All the way back to the wall. 200 degrees. Did you see this, Miss Glenna? Even though the sunlight wasn't very direct, it still got 200 degrees. This morning, for Miss Deborah's class, it got up to 300 degrees. So, let's check and see if the water's pasteurized. Now, how do we know with our water purificator? If the wax melts. Let's check it out. Woo, can you see some heat waves coming up there?
Yeah.
Now, that is hot. Woo! Now here's my hot pan. Ta-da! Here's the experiment. It's not melted. I think maybe it wasn't down in the water enough. Oh, you know what? Even though it was 200 degrees, it didn't get quite hot enough in here. Let's do this experiment again on Monday.
Right.
It didn't. If this would have been here longer, it would have melted. I think this water is about 150. We should put it back out in the sun and turn it towards, so it's